being here at this special time where the Torah portion of the week, a couple days ago, we read about Noah. And, you know, the synagogue looks a little archy over here, so I think it's very special that you read about Noah. This past week, one of our ministers in the Israeli cabinet gave a Dvar Torah where he compared Netanyahu to Noah. You know, it took Noah a long time to build that ark. And during that time, 120 years or so, right, Rabbi? During that time, the different people who would go by and see him would ask him that same question over and over again. Hey, man, why are you building the boat? And the answer that he would give was, because you're bad. And God is going to punish you eventually. And there's going to be a great big flood. And people didn't believe him. People didn't take it seriously. But he kept on warning the world. Well, Netanyahu has been warning the world about Iran for a very long time. I'll read you a little bit of a speech from Netanyahu. He said, if this regime were to acquire nuclear weapons, it could have catastrophic consequences not only for my country and for the Middle East, but for all mankind. And the deadline for attaining this goal of stopping the nuclearization of Iran is getting extremely close. It sounds like he made this speech in the Knesset today. No, he made the speech to Congress. In 1996, July 10th, 1996. I'll read that last line again. The deadline for preventing the nuclearization of Iran is getting extremely close. 1996. Sounds like Noah to me. And I just hope and pray that there won't be a flood. That the world will listen to Israel. That the world will listen to Netanyahu in his efforts and our efforts in general in Israel to keep the world safe. And so what we're going to be going through today, tonight's topic is peace, politics, and projectiles and plutonium, an insider's look at the mayhem in the Middle East. And so we're going to go through what's going on in the Middle East and get you up to date. Here we have our map of the Middle East. You don't have to squint if you're in the back. The yellow countries are the ones that don't like us very much, okay? That's all, just the yellow ones. And so my job is to get you up to date on what's going on in most of these countries over here. And there's different perspectives on what's going on. And there is a positive perspective, and there's a negative perspective, and I'm going to give you both of those perspectives. But because we're Jewish, I'm going to start with a negative. And we're going to go through them one by one. And if we're going to be starting with a negative, then we're going to be starting with ISIS, right? You know, plenty to worry about with ISIS. We're very concerned about the progress that this very nasty terrorist group is making, trying to create a caliphate in the Middle East. We already have an Islamic Republic in Iran that's Shiite. Now they have to have their own Sunni Islamic caliphate, and they've already made a lot of progress. The land that they already control in Iraq and in Syria is already 20 times the size of Israel. And so we have to take it very, very seriously. They're already posing an indirect threat to Israel by taking over parts of Syria. You know, they're only a four-hour drive away from Israel. These people who like lopping off the heads of journalists. We have to take seriously that they're threatening the King of Jordan. You know, they could be our neighbor in our largest border. And so that's definitely something to worry about. We also have to be worried about distraction that the that ISIS has posed to the leading nations of the world that are so focused on fighting them that they're going to forget about Iran, which is not a passing threat like ISIS might be, a fad in the Middle East, but a very serious long-term threat. The last time America decided to go to war in Iraq in 2003, what happened was Iran froze their nuclear weapons program. And because they were worried, they thought America is invading Iraq, we must be next. But then when they saw that the world was so focused on Iraq that they were ignoring them, they restarted their nuclear weapons program. And the world let them get away with it. And we're very worried that that's exactly what's going to happen again. And the last thing that we're worried about with ISIS is that we would, for some reason, in Israel, be blamed for the rise of ISIS. And it sort of happened in a speech that Kerry made a couple weeks ago. He's backtracked from it, and we'll give him credit that he didn't really mean to say it. But what he seemed to suggest was that young Muslims in the Middle East are frustrated because of Israel or because of the lack of a peace process, and because of that, they've joined ISIS. Now, actually, they're kind of frustrated about what's going on in their countries. They're kind of frustrated with what's going on in the Arab and Muslim world, and that's why they've joined an effort to fight fellow Muslims. If they wanted to fight us, then they could have. There was a war in Gaza this summer. They could have gone there and fought us and fired rockets at us or dug tunnels. But they were fighting their fellow Muslims. And one of the positives that we can say, if there's any positive regarding ISIS, is that they don't, or at least barely, mention us. They are focused on their own efforts to make countries in the Middle East more religious and to become Islamic states. They don't talk about the Jewish state very much, and we've managed to stay out of it, and we don't intend to get into it. Another positive that we can say is that, looking back, it was probably a smart thing that Israel destroyed, according to foreign sources, we can't write such things, that Israel destroyed a nuclear reactor that was being built in Syria. That nuclear reactor was in a place called Deir el-Azur, which is the oil-producing area of Syria, and ISIS is all about capturing oil-producing areas, and so that's one of the places in Syria that they've captured. Could you imagine, if not for Israel, these crazy people would have already had a nuclear bomb? And so I think that we can be thankful to Israel for preventing that from happening. And if the Secretary of State or other administration officials are going to connect Israel to ISIS, I hope that it would be for that. And the final thing that's positive regarding ISIS is Israel has to be very thankful to the United States, because the American military Air Force is making progress in its fight against ISIS. At first, the Israelis were skeptical. They heard an American president rule out ground forces in advance, something that didn't sound like sound military strategy. They saw how the Army, the Air Force, was having only about 5 sorties a day. By comparison, in the war in Gaza, Israel had 250 a day. We didn't understand what America was doing. It didn't look like a serious effort militarily. But it's already been very successful in destroying the military infrastructure and the oil-producing economic facilities of ISIS. That's already put the brakes on ISIS in Syria, had serious progress against ISIS in Iraq. And looking from a military point of view, from Israel, at the American military campaign, the Israeli generals look at it with jealousy. because we see how they can strike them over time in a measured kind of way, in a way that we wish we could. They can take their time. And we in Israel don't have that luxury, because we know at any given point, soon after Israel takes steps to defend its people, that the entire world starts condemning things. That we only have a limited amount of time for any military campaign. America doesn't have that limitation. You know, America is the world. America can do whatever it wants to do. And so we wish in Israel that we could do what we need to do to protect our people the way America can conduct the military campaign that it is in Iraq right now. And so they are making progress, and we really do appreciate what's going on there, that ISIS can be contained, and the rise of another caliphate in the Middle East can be prevented, which leads us to that other caliphate, to Iran. There are positives and negatives to say about what's going on in Iran. The positive is that it's looking like, no, we said we'd start with a negative, right? So the negative is that there could very well be a deal, if not by the November 24th deadline for the P5 plus one countries, then in the months ahead. And the positive is that there might be a deal between the P5 plus one and Iran. And it's the same exact thing. And it all depends on what that deal will be. Right now, Iran, if it wanted to, could already produce a nuclear weapon in about 3 months. And both Israel and the United States have said that any kind of deal would have to keep them at least a year away from getting a bomb and have proper mechanisms, proper serious monitoring to prevent Iran from getting a bomb. Both Israel and the United States have said no deal is better than a bad deal. And yet, the question will be, what is defined as a bad deal? You know, whatever happens, Netanyahu, if there's any kind of deal, Netanyahu will have to condemn it. Because Netanyahu talking tough is what has made the world take action to prevent the nuclearization of Iran. The biting sanctions that have had a serious effect have only been put on because Netanyahu raised the world's consciousness on Iran. Any concessions that that Iran has already made that led to the interim agreement, that's already distanced themselves, Iran, from getting the bomb, it's all because of what Israel has done. Iran is reeling. Iran has lost billions and billions because of the sanctions that have been put on. And that's why they feel this pressure to reach a deal and get these sanctions removed. And so there is new hope that Iran's nuclearization can be prevented by non-military means. But we hope that the international community will make sure that no bad deal is reached. And we are concerned. The chief negotiator of the international community with Iran, Catherine Ashton, the European Foreign Secretary, she is finishing up her post. And we're very worried that she wants to make a deal now, before she's done, in order to have an accomplishment before she leaves office, her first accomplishment. And so that's something that we're very worried about in Israel. But we can be satisfied with the way that the world is taking Iran a lot more seriously than they ever were before, and that there is hope to prevent the nuclearization of Iran by non-military means. And one of the reasons why that's so important is that in Lebanon, there are 100,000 rockets aimed at Israel today that were intended to be used in order to retaliate if someone would attack Iran. 100,000 rockets. Think about that. There were 4,500 rockets fired at Israel this summer in 50 days. Imagine if you have 100,000 rockets, 20 times as much as were fired from Gaza, fired in a week. You know, we're very proud of our Iron Dome missile defense system, but we've never, it has never faced such a challenge of such a huge amount of rockets being fired, nor has any country ever faced such a serious challenge. But one thing that we can say that's positive is that they didn't get involved in the fighting this summer. You know, Hezbollah does not like the Jewish people any more than Hamas. Had they gotten involved this summer in the war, it could have been a lot more difficult for Israel. But they stayed out of it because Iran would not let them enter the war. Iran wants those rockets saved to use as retaliation if someone would attack them. And it's looking more and more likely that that is not going to happen. Now, another positive regarding Hezbollah from Israel's standpoint is that they have lost a lot of their top fighters in the fighting that's going on in Syria. Now, in Syria, it's absolutely terrible. 150,000 people have been killed without the world lifting a finger. 150,000. Now, what is the world doing? The world has started fighting not against Bashar Assad, but against his enemies, against ISIS. And in Israel, we really don't get it. We've tried to wake up the world. We've tried to do our part in sending humanitarian aid to Syria, in taking out the Jews that were there. You know, you've got hundreds of thousands of refugees from Syria, and the only ones that found a home are the Jews who were evacuated out of Syria. And there's the other humanitarian step that Israel has taken, taking in more than 1,200 wounded Syrians into Israeli hospitals. Now, none of them are Jewish. This is tikkun olam. This is our part in healing the world. You know, these Syrians, they wake up in Israeli hospitals, and when they're told where they are, they're in shock. You know, did you take me here as a hostage? Did you take me here to kill me? No. Israeli doctors, Jews, just saved your life. And they're really, really surprised. And then they go home and they tell people what Israel really is. And we can be very proud of it. Now, in Syria, we can say that from Israel's perspective, it's not such a bad thing that they have been busy. You know, we see it as a terrible tragedy that they are killing each other. You know, we Jewish people, we don't like to see our enemies die. That's the way we are. How many cups of wine did you have on Passover? Four, either the birthright kids that your rabbi chaperoned in Israel. You know, when I ask them how many cups of wine, they say 12. Did any of you stick your finger in the cup and take out 10 drops? Why'd you do that? That's not so sanitary. 10 plagues. But the Egyptians, they deserve those plagues. You know, they were nasty to us. They enslaved us. And yet our cup can't be full, knowing that our enemies have suffered. That's the way we look at what's going on in Syria. We see it as a terrible tragedy. But then again, all those armaments that they have there in Syria that they've used against their people, all those weapons were intended not for their people, but for us, for Israel. And they've been wasted. They've been wasted on their own people. According to Israeli security officials, Syria has only about 10% of the firepower that they had when the fighting began. That's all. Keep in mind that the IDF was built up over time to defend Israel from what traditionally have been the three strongest Arab armies, which traditionally have been Syria, Iraq, and Egypt. Well, Syria has 10% of the firepower that they had before. Iraq has almost nothing. And Egypt is our friend. We have a better relationship with Egypt than we've had with any regime that there's been in Egypt since Joseph. Going all the way back. And so we really appreciate what General Sisi has done in terms of making sure that the Hamas smuggling has stopped from Egypt into Gaza. He announced this week he's even going to be building a security barrier in between Egypt and Gaza to ensure that there won't be new rockets in Gaza. We hope that he'll succeed, because the international community failed last time. They failed the people of Gaza by not preventing all the money that flowed into Gaza from reaching Hamas. The international community's money was intended to build schools and playgrounds and hospitals. Instead, it was diverted by Hamas to build tunnels in order to attack our schools, playgrounds, and hospitals. Because the international community did not monitor its money and allowed Hamas to become strong, they enabled Hamas to attack Israel. The blood of the people who died in Gaza is very much in the hands of those donor states, and they need to make sure that they don't repeat the mistakes that they made. We have to put the blame really in the hands of Hamas, who started that war, who kidnapped our three boys. And it's not only Israel that blames Hamas, it's Abbas also. You know, you might have heard Abbas's speech in the UN, where he accused Israel of genocide. That's what he says publicly when he wants to make an impression. When he doesn't think journalists are listening to him, he speaks differently. On August 21st, near the end of the war in Gaza, there was a meeting of Abbas and the leader of Hamas, Khaled Mashal, in Qatar, which is the country that funds terrorism all around the world. And Abbas said to Mashal, "Why did you kidnap those three kids?" He didn't say settlers, he did in the UN. Children, he called them. "Why did you kidnap those three kids? What was the goal?" He accused Hamas of trying to cause unrest in the West Bank, to try to topple him. And he blamed Hamas for what resulted in an Arab boy, Mohammed Abu Khader, being killed by a group of crazy Jewish teens. He blamed Hamas for what the Jewish teens had done to this Arab boy. That's Abbas, it's not Israel. In another speech, when he didn't think the media was listening because he had kicked them out of the room, in a meeting of the Arab League in Egypt, Abbas scoffed at Hamas's claim that it had won the war with Israel. "Which victory are they talking about?" he asked. He ridiculed Hamas's rocket attacks at Israel during the war. He said, quote, "They fired 4,000 rockets that killed only three Israelis." And he said that the ceasefire that Hamas agreed to at the end of the war had the exact same terms as the proposal offered at the beginning, when the number of Palestinians who had been killed was only 180. This is Abbas talking. It's not Israel. And now he actually was making it sound worse for Israel. The number of rockets that killed Israelis, if you count only Jewish Israeli civilians that were killed by rockets, not by mortars, it actually wasn't three. It was zero. Think about it. 4,500 rockets and the amount of Jewish Israeli civilians killed was none at all. And Baruch Hashem, the cantor says, thank God. And people think we lost the war. Now, just keep in mind, though, that we had different objectives during the war. Our objective was to restore quiet. Our objective was to minimize civilian deaths on both sides of the border. Thanks to the Iron Dome missile defense system, we succeeded in minimizing civilian deaths on our side of the border. We did everything possible to minimize civilian deaths on the other side, and we did not always succeed. But every strike had lawyers involved approving it. And while we were trying to minimize civilian deaths on both sides of the border, Hamas was trying to maximize civilian deaths on both sides of the border. They succeeded on their side. They didn't succeed on our side. But on their side, where they have more control, they succeeded. They made sure to fire almost only from civilian areas, almost only from where there were children. While Israel would drop leaflets and send messages, text messages, and call to tell people to evacuate when they're about to attack a certain area, Hamas then wouldn't let the people leave in order to maximize those civilian deaths. That was their strategy, because every single Arab killed in Gaza was a victory for Hamas in trying to embarrass Israel around the world. And every civilian killed in Gaza was a loss for Israel. It's a different kind of war, asymmetric warfare. The rules of the game are different. And asymmetric warfare makes it more complicated when the battle shifts as it's going to into a legal battlefield where Israel's ready to defend itself against any charges that there are going to be. Is Hamas ready? I don't know. Hamas consistently committed war crimes in this war. Attacking civilians is a war crime. Using weapons like rockets that can't be aimed at a specific target is a war crime. Using human shields, war crime. Transporting fighters in ambulances, war crime. Using hospitals as military bases, war crime. Using children as fighters and tunnel diggers, war crime. Attempting to take hostages, war crime even if you fail. And so things are going to be tough if this for Hamas, if they are put on trial. And so there were terrible things that happened during the war. Jews having to run for their lives all the time, having 15 seconds when a siren goes off. If they're in southern Israel, we in Jerusalem, we had only 5 sirens and we had a whole minute. Now the entire country has faced this challenge. If they were attacking only in a place where there's tension among Israelis, where there's differences of opinion, like the West Bank, then Israelis wouldn't have united. But because they were attacking left-wing communities in southern Israel, because they were attacking Tel Aviv, because they were attacking our airport, the people of Israel as a whole united in support of the IDF and the government in its efforts to stop the rockets from being fired. Seeing the way Israelis united was a very beautiful thing. I'm the political correspondent. My job is to write when Israelis fight with each other. And this time, during the war, for a couple weeks there, I could go to a movie. I didn't have anything to write in the Jerusalem Post. And so we've seen how no matter what they've done to try to harm Israel, it hasn't worked out. They've tried to harm Israel with conventional warfare and failed. They've tried to harm Israel with terrorism, with suicide bombers, and failed. They've tried to harm Israel with rockets and failed. They've tried to harm Israel with tunnels and failed. They've tried to harm Israel with flotillas and fly tillas and every kind of tilla, and failed. And they've tried to harm Israel with international boycotts, and they're not doing too well. This past week, I briefed one of the international credit agencies. Whenever the international credit agencies come to Israel, Moody's, Standard & Poor's, and Fitch, I brief them on behalf of the finance ministry. They want to have a journalist talk to them and talk about what's going on in internal Israeli politics. And so normally I do most of the talking. And so when I met the gentleman from Fitch last week, At the end, I asked them a question. I said, how are these boycotts that they're trying to do to Israel and all these divestment campaigns, what's the impact on the Israeli economy? And he said to me, in a very serious kind of way, he said, part of my job is to monitor them. In my report every year, I have to write about the impact of the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement on the Israeli economy. And so I research it in great depth. And every time I study it, I find that the impact that there has been on the Israeli economy is zero. No impact whatsoever. So they try to attack us with that too, and fail. And now they're going to be trying some international effort to try to get a Palestinian state recognized by the United Nations. Try to get the international community to give them a Palestinian state, not for land for peace, but for land for no peace. And that's not going to work either. There needs to be, as Netanyahu says, some thinking outside the box, and the peace process can be advanced. We in Israel, we never give up our hope of achieving peace, even though it's become more of a challenge in an era when the peace partners accuse us of genocide in the UN, in an era when we're facing security challenges on all sides. We're never going to give up our hope. But while we're waiting for this peace and this security that are so elusive to come, we in Israel are going to continue to thrive against all odds. During the war this summer, Intel decided to invest another $6 billion in Israel. And they don't spend their money on nothing. They know what they're doing. In defiance of the BDS boycott, where a lot of their support comes from Britain, Israel's exports to Britain surged by 38% compared to the same period last year. In Forbes' top 10 list of health companies that are changing the world that they put out a couple months ago, five of the 10 companies were Israeli. In the top IPOs from Wall Street of the past year, two of the 10 were Israeli. One was Mobileye that had its IPO during the war this summer in Gaza. The largest Israeli IPO in history happened during a war for a company that is working on preventing car accidents all around the world with its technology, something that we can be very proud of for Israel. One of the other IPOs was for a company called ReWalk that's allowing paraplegics to walk all around the world, another thing to be proud of. And that brings us back to Ebola. And we started with Ebola, right? And that's what the focus of the news is on here. An Israeli biotech company called Protalix is ready to replenish supplies of the experimental Ebola vaccine, ZMapp, around the world, saving lives. And so I can tell you, I've never been more proud to be Israeli. I've never been more proud to be American. And I hope and I pray that there are better days ahead for both countries. Thank you very much. Sharon's question is about the leader of Hamas in Gaza, Ismail Haniyeh. Remember Khaled Mashal, who we mentioned before, the real leader of Hamas. He's based in Qatar. He lives a very lavish lifestyle over there while his people in Gaza are suffering by him preventing international investment from around the world from coming there. And so Ismail Haniyeh, his daughter, was very sick, and she went to medical treatment at Ichlob Hospital in Tel Aviv, which saved her life. That's who we are. And so how does he get away with it, was the question. You know, Hamas are a totalitarian regime. They weren't elected to lead the people of Gaza. You know, people said that all the time during the war. I heard people say, oh, the people of Gaza deserved it. They elected Hamas. Not true. What Hamas won was an election for parliament, not for president. Okay, I know we have somebody here running for Congress. The parliament of the Palestinians is not Congress. It is not a powerful body at all. It has as much power as your condominium association here on Long Island. It's barely even met. Okay, the leader of the Palestinians is Abbas. He was the one elected, although it was a while ago. He is supposed to be in charge of Gaza. And the way that Hamas took power was not through an election, but through a coup. Or I don't like the word coup, I like the word overthrow, because it describes better what happened in Gaza. The Hamas in Gaza took Abbas's people and threw them off the top of buildings. So they literally overthrew Abbas's people. That's how they took power in Gaza. And so Hamas is really mistreating its people. Israel built a field hospital on the border between Israel and Gaza to treat Arabs who were wounded during the war. Keep in mind, every single Arab wounded, we did not want that to happen. And Israel wanted to treat them. Hamas did not let them enter that field hospital. And now, hypocritically, the leader of Hamas sends his daughter to Israel for medical treatment. It's horrible. Shortly after Obama took power, I told the owners of the Jerusalem Post that they should do something that they don't like to do, which is spend money. By taking polls, seeing what Israelis think about the administration in Washington. And the first poll, he did relatively well. The first poll was back in May 2009, right before he started dealing with Israel. And we asked Israelis, is he going to be more pro-Israel, more pro-Palestinian, or neutral? Which is the ultimate bellwether question. And so he did all right. The percentage saying he's more pro-Israel was 31%. The percentage saying he's more pro-Palestinian was 14%. That was May. Then came June. A couple things happened between May and June. First of all, there was a speech in Cairo where Obama compared what the Palestinians had been through to the Holocaust, more or less. And that upset a lot of Israelis. Second of all, there was a meeting between Netanyahu and Obama in the White House that went badly. It was where Obama first showed an obsession with settlements that would prevent there from being a peace process for a few years. And so the numbers changed dramatically. The percentage saying he's more pro-Palestinian went up from 14% to 50% in 3 weeks. The percentage saying he's more pro-Israel went down from 31% to only 6%. Obama's advisors saw this, and they said, oy vey. We've lost mainstream Israel. We were counting on mainstream Israel to make concessions in order to move the peace process forward. We can't allow this number to get any lower. And in fact, it did. In August 2009, it fell to only 4%, which, if you think about it, is almost mathematically impossible. The poll had a margin of error of 4.5%. That meant that there were people who hadn't even been born yet who had a problem with the President of the United States. But don't worry, the numbers went up over time to the point that in September 2011, the number went up to 54%, and Obama was doing relatively well. That was the month where he went to the United Nations and prevented a Palestinian state from being declared unilaterally along the pre-67 border. Later on, more recent polls found that the percentage of Israelis saying that Obama is more pro-Israel and more pro-Palestinian was exactly the same, an exact tie. And the most recent poll that we took found that Israelis, when asked that same question, is he more pro-Israel, more pro-Palestinian, or neutral, gave an answer that I never thought Israelis would give, which is the answer, I don't know. Now, a lot of you have been to Israel. Have you ever heard an Israeli say, I don't know about anything? You know, if you ask an Israeli for directions, they'll tell you to go straight, whether they know or not. And then Israelis went and sold a GPS to Google for $1 billion. That's the way we are in Israel. And so we don't know. If Obama succeeds at preventing the nuclearization of Iran by non-military means, Israelis will be very thankful to him and remember him in a positive way. If he fails, then Israelis are going to remember him negatively, and so will America. And so if you ask why were his poll numbers low, it's a matter of policy, not personality. I'll tell you, when I moved to Israel, the question was about the way Israel's seen in the media. When I moved to Israel back in 1999, Israel didn't even have an English language spokesman. The Prime Minister of Israel at the time, Ehud Barak, did not think it was important, and so he didn't appoint one. Then when he was replaced by Ariel Sharon, Sharon brought in Ronan Gissin, who defended Israel very well, man who spent a lot of his life in Long Island, defended Israel well, but with an aggressive New York accent. When Olmert took over for Sharon, he replaced Ronan with Miri Eisen, with a woman, who did a great job defending Israel during the war that there was in Lebanon. When she retired, Olmert replaced her with Mark Regev, who still is our spokesman to this very day. And I think he's doing a good job. You know, when Netanyahu took over for Olmert, he replaced all of Olmert's people, as a different administration with different views would. The only one he kept on was Mark. And Netanyahu was supposed to know a thing or two about how to talk to the media around the world. And if he thought Mark is the right person to be doing it, then he really must be doing something right. But you're right. The Palestinians have made a lot of progress in presenting its message around the world. And so we have to do our part in presenting our message and explaining things the best way that we can. That includes on college campuses, where we used to be at a great disadvantage, and the tide is turning. I'm saying that as someone who has spoken on college campuses in 46 states, in America, the toughest campuses in Canada, in London, and in Johannesburg. What's changed is that the Jewish students, who a few years ago were running scared, now are empowered and are educated. There are all kinds of programs that are training them to be ready. And they're making a lot of headway. You know, programs like Hasbara, which is IsraelActivism.com, and Stand With Us, are, you know, training them, making them into animals, defending Israel on college campuses, having them be ready to take both proactive and reactive approaches in defending Israel. From both the perspective of Israel beyond the conflict, of what Israel's doing to make the world a better place, and Israel within the conflict. And that's not only happening on college campuses. It's happening in conversations around America. Social media. To answer your question, Susan, of what you can do. You know, I used to say write letters to the editor, and that helps, and write your congressman and everything. But now the world has changed to the detriment of us journalists. Because now everyone's a journalist in one way or another. You know, I'm sure most of the people in the room are on Facebook. You know, you got to see pictures of your grandchildren. That's probably the best way of doing it. And so if you're on Facebook or Twitter already, then click like on IDF or follow the IDF on Twitter. Then you can get your news directly. And then you can spread that news to all your friends. And you can retweet. And you can make sure that the news gets out there about what the truth is. The slogan of the Israeli Water Authority is Chaval al kol tipa. Every drop matters. All of you are a drop, and all of you matter in getting the proper information out, getting out the truth. And the more you do, the better it will be for Israel. And the polls in America show that Americans see Israel as one of America's top allies. So you must be doing something right. The question was about how Israel handles different power struggles among the Palestinians and the different parties and everything and the different terrorist groups. And so there eventually has to be a Palestinian election. The last election for president of the Palestinian Authority was in January 2005. That means that Abbas is about to celebrate the 10th year anniversary of him being elected to a four-year term. And so it's not exactly democratic, but eventually there will have to be a Palestinian election. And if extremists are elected, there's not going to be a peace process. And Israel will do everything possible to protect its people. And if relative moderates, everything is relative in the Middle East, are elected, then we'll talk to them. We're on guard. Being Israeli is about hoping for the best and preparing for the worst. And that means whoever's in charge of the Palestinians, be it Fatah, Hamas, ISIS, will be ready. There are a couple questions there. One was about the potential of Hamas rearming itself and there being another war between Israel and Hamas. And the other was about Netanyahu's public opinion right now in Israel. And so I'll answer the part about Hamas first. There's no doubt Hamas is going to rearm. Hamas is going to do everything possible to rearm, and the international community will likely fail the Palestinian people again and enable Hamas to rearm. And we are getting ready. The aspect of your question about why Netanyahu did not go the entire way in actually destroying Hamas is that he didn't have the courage, to be honest. You know, it would have resulted in a lot of Israeli soldiers being killed. Now, keep in mind, in Israel, it's different than other countries. It might be the only country in the world where soldiers being killed is seen as more of a tragedy than civilians. Because the IDF is the great unifying force in Israel, and except for the ultra-Orthodox and the Arabs, everyone sends their kids to the IDF, risk their lives. And so those are our boys. And so, had you had hundreds of soldiers being killed, it would have been the end of Netanyahu's political career, no matter what happened. And so Israelis are frustrated that there's no definite end to rocket fire. But as a leader, you have to take your risks into account, and sometimes you have to take the lesser of all evils. And that's what Netanyahu did. He had only a limited ground incursion. It might have looked like it was a lot more on CNN, but he had the IDF enter one neighborhood in one Palestinian city just in order to stop the tunnels and nothing else. That's what he did. It was very limited because Israel did not want to take that risk, and because Israel does not want to control the Palestinian people. Not only because Netanyahu said time and time again that he wants the Palestinians to have independence not only in Gaza but in the West Bank as well, but also because it's very expensive to run another country. And we have enough problems of our own without having to be in charge it's much easier for Netanyahu to govern a country that has only 6% unemployment like we have in Israel than it is to govern Gaza where you have 40% unemployment. So there are many reasons why Netanyahu decided not to topple Hamas entirely, and knowing full well that there could be another war between Israel and Hamas again. As for Netanyahu's popularity, okay, the polls have found that there is no serious alternative to Netanyahu in Israel. The choice given that attracts the most support out of any potential candidate against Netanyahu in every public opinion poll that's been taken over the last few years is none of the above. No other candidate other than none of the above ever gets more than 10% in a poll against Netanyahu because Israelis trust him with their security, not with their economy, but with their security. And so he's doing very well in the polls, and we're stuck with him in one way or another. The question was about Israel building in Jerusalem and in the West Bank, and while our enemies are going to continue to try to kill us, we're going to continue to build. Building is living, and no one's going to stop us from that, especially in Jerusalem. In Jerusalem, there's a severe housing shortage. It's terrible. The prices have gone way up because there's not enough construction going on. As a Jerusalem resident, regardless of politics, I hope they build a lot more. Because I want to buy a home. The home that I have, when I bought it, I asked the realtor, hey, what side of the pre-67 border is it on? She didn't even know. The lines don't look like they did during those 19 terrible years when Jordan controlled part of Jerusalem and Jews were not allowed to enter the old city. And to see any of their holy sites. Since then, for both Jews and Arabs, Jerusalem has gotten a lot bigger, thank God. I asked a tour guide who lives down the street from me. Tour guides know everything, right? He didn't know what side of the pre-67 border I lived on either. I didn't know what side of the pre-67 border I lived on until I was looking for directions on something called Google Earth. And I saw a dotted line going through my house. Until then, I didn't know that I sleep in Israel, and I go to the bathroom in occupied Jordan. I didn't know that every time I pish, I'm an obstacle to peace. And so the border is going to be decided in negotiations. We were in the middle of negotiations a few months ago, in March. And the Palestinians ran away from the negotiating table, just like they did back in September 2008, when Ehud Olmert offered the Palestinians 100% of the West Bank with land swaps, 100%. Offered to take in thousands of Palestinian refugees, even though there were a lot more Jews expelled from Arab and Muslim countries when the State of Israel was created than there were Arabs who fled the new Jewish state. And last but not least, Olmert offered to divide Jerusalem, to have the Arab neighborhoods of Jerusalem become the capital of a Palestinian state, and to have the entire old city of Jerusalem internationalized under the control of five countries, the United States, the new Palestinian state, Israel, Jordan, and Saudi Arabia. Olmert intended to bring that plan to the United Nations, where it would have been approved by every country in the world that month, had the Palestinians said yes. But instead, the Palestinians ran away from the table. Had they said yes, everyone would know on where the border would be and where everyone could build. But until there is a border decided in negotiations, it's disputed territory in which both sides have the right to build according to international law. And so Netanyahu sometimes plays lip service to the international community, announces freezes and all kinds of things to try to look good. Sometimes he panders more to the public, which wants to see building in Israel. And so it's politics when he builds, politics when he pretends to build. Every time an announcement is made, sometimes it's just advancing a building project from stage 2 to stage 3 in a 20-stage building process. What prevents the peace process from moving forward is not building. It's making a big deal out of whether a Jew lives here or over there. And the more the international community does that, the more peace will come become farther away. And it's a tragedy that they keep on doing that. So what I'd like to end with, people always ask me, what can I do to help Israel from where I live? And I think Susan alluded to it a little bit before. And I tell people that helping Israel is easy, E-A-S-Y, which stands for education, advocacy, solidarity, and your money. Now, I'm not going to talk about the why. You have a gentleman here from Israel Bonds, an organization that I speak for all over the country, including in Puerto Rico, which was a really nice gig. So I'll focus just briefly on the other three before you go home and watch football. Education, you know, you have a very informed audience for your informed synagogue here, Rabbi. The rabbi must be doing something right over here. Keep on getting your news from Israeli news sources in English, like the Jerusalem Post, www.jpost.com. I'm not only saying that because they put hummus on my table, but also because we are indeed the best source of news online and for a print newspaper about what's going on. I also work for something new called voiceofisrael.com that I recommend you check out. I have a daily radio show right now. I'm on vacation. A is for advocacy. Be involved in your pro-Israel movements. We need all the help that we could get. And S is for solidarity with Israel, which you showed by coming here, having this wonderful turnout here in Bellmore. Coming to Israel next time the rabbi organizes a trip, she should have a lot more people with her. I could tell she wants to have more missions to Israel coming up. Israel is in her heart and she wears it on her sleeve, and I could tell the same of so many of her congregants. And the real why we're in a synagogue is your prayers, that we pray here that there should be a better day ahead for the people of Israel, for all the people of this region, for the people who have Ebola, and for the people here in America. Thank you very much.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support Shalom TV on JBS with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the Shalom TV website homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to JEM. To JEM, P.O. Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.